Good afternoon, folks. Welcome back to the show. We just had a great segment with Tova Tolman talking all about the public universities in Georgia, University of Georgia, Georgia Tech, and how to approach their supplements with the Common App. Now, for our next segment, we want to stick with the Common App, but what we want to focus on are some of the lesser utilized components of the application, or at least I would say the space where students have the most opportunity to be able to improve the quality of their application. And to talk about these different elements of the application, I'd like to bring onto the show my colleague here in Portland, Christine Sawicki. Hey, Christine.
Hi, Ian.
Hey, great to have you. So you told me that one of your goals is to come on the radio show a little bit more often. And you thought you would start with this particular segment because you love this stuff. You are really into the activities list and the honors and awards section and just all of the other things I think in the Common App that people don't usually think about or ask about because they're so focused on the essay. They're so focused on the supplements. Why do you like the activities list so much?
I think the activities list is perhaps the most underutilized space within the Common App. The way that Common App presents the activities list, it feels really administrative, and students typically have just finished filling out the profile in the education section, and so they're in the mindset of administrative. The boxes are small, there's drop-down menus, but that activities list, having reviewed applications on the other side, is as important, if not even more important in some cases, than the actual personal essay. So I love helping students put on the brakes when they get to that activities section and really think strategically about how to use the fairly limited space to really let their involvement outside of the classroom shine. And I think it's kind of a fun puzzle to use that limited space to do so.
And I love that you're sort of going through the actual user experience of the Common App, because if you go in there, you're going to see some info on profile and education and family. And it just feels like, okay, I know the answer to these questions. I'm just going to type in my dad's name and where my dad works, or I'm going to enter in where my mom went to school. And then you come to the activity section and it looks like more of the same. Oh, you know, what's the first activity that I was involved in? I guess I'll just enter that in. And what you're saying is that this is something that really is more qualitative than students think about, and it's an opportunity for them to really make an impact. Let's talk a little bit about the activities list, because there was a slight change this year to how students were able to present information. You get 50 characters to describe your role or title within a particular activity. You get 100 characters to name that activity. You have to choose what type of activity it is from a drop-down list. Again, that's a sort of data entry component that you're talking about. But I think that the space where there maybe is the most opportunity is in the details. You get 150 characters, not words, but 150 characters to describe your activity. So in total, Christine, there are 300 characters that students get to use here. How should they think strategically about using those 300 characters? Is there a way to think about them as one collective group, rather than thinking about them as separate entities? How do you advise students to think strategically about this?
I actually think you said it exactly, is to not think about it as separate boxes, but to think of them as working together. You have one entry that will flow with all of the boxes and the drop-down menus together. And so I think the first tip that I would give to students is to reduce redundancy across those entry boxes. So often there's redundancy, which takes away the characters that you have. Varsity tennis captain will be your title, and then you start your description. I am on the varsity tennis team and am captain. Right. I already know that from the previous box. You can just jump in at that description point with what you did on that team and in that role.
That's right. And so when we think about, all right, I've got my title, I've got the name of the organization, what about this details section? I think students often get tripped up here, and there can be places where maybe they've got tons of details they want to include. There might be others where, let's say I played on the baseball team for 2 years, I didn't win any awards, I might not have details. How would students sort of think about using that? Do you always put something in the details section, and what goes there?
Yes, I would encourage to always have something there.
Always. Okay.
And I think it's important to start with thinking about your pinnacle achievement or accomplishment within that given activity. Did you make it to the district competition? Did you get third place? Did you get something published? Think about what the pinnacle moment of the activity is, and that tends to be a good lead to start that description. Mm-hmm. After that, you can think of secondary and tertiary points to bring in of accomplishment. I also think that some activities don't have a pinnacle achievement. And in that case, the description can be a little bit more qualitative in terms of kind of impact from a qualitative standpoint of what you did. Brought a cheerful enthusiasm to each club meeting, for example.
Yeah, of course, that's the example you choose, the cheerful enthusiasm. I don't know why, but for those of you who can't see Christine, she's got a big smile right now. So cheerful enthusiasm, a little bit more of that character and personality might come through.
Yeah. And I think most students approach the activities list in a really dry kind of official or professional resume type voice, which is often very effective to deliver a lot of content within the activities list. But if you can spice up with a little bit of personality or a little exclamation point somewhere in there, it wakes up an admission officer on the other end. And I always appreciate it if a student was funny, there may be a little quip within one of the descriptions, or if a student is genuinely a smiley, happy person, to use that exclamation point in there to make a point. It is an opportunity to not just look objectively at what you've done, but provide the meaning of that activity to you.
Now, when I was talking to Tova in the last segment, we were talking a little bit about the Georgia essay and how they have this word of amusing an admission officer, and that some students might not feel like they can be amusing, and it maybe doesn't fit for them to try to be funny in this space. Are there students who are sort of better disposed to be creative in this particular space? Would you tell some students to sort of play it more by the book? Like, how should students think about bringing themselves into this activities list, given the narrow window of space that's provided?
Yeah, I think authenticity in any spot within the application is absolutely essential. So if you are not funny, it is not the time to make your first joke in your activities list. But I think there can be, for students that might be a little bit shyer in bringing that forward, you can use this I guess in a little bit of a more strategic way. For example, I was working with a student who tutored once a week for 1 hour. It was not a big commitment, but it was really meaningful to her. And she really loved that hour that she got to sit down. And so she added just a little small phrase at the end of her description, "best part of my week," exclamation point.
Nice.
And all of a sudden, that activity that would have just been, a little thing, had the spotlight on it of being really meaningful to her.
Yeah, I like that a lot. And I think you can look for places to do that. You can try and bring a little bit about how you actually feel about these activities, especially in ones where you don't have a longer description. Now, Christine, there will be some activities where a student might have a lot of awards or they might have won some recognition. And I want to bring in now the other segment of this Common App that I think gets even less focused than the activities list, which is the awards and honor section. Now, in that particular space, you can list up to 5 awards or honors, and you have 100 characters to provide a description. You can also indicate whether that award or honor was won at the school level, the regional level, the state level, the national level, or the international level. So there's a way of sort of designating how you won that award. How would you encourage students to think about the awards or honors that they've won for activities that they participate in? If I was the state champion for debate, should that go in my activities description, or should I put that in the awards and honors section?
The activities section.
Well, that's a definitive. Usually it depends, but you just, okay.
No. If you have an award that's associated with an extracurricular activity, I think it is most powerful when it is in the description in the activity section.
Okay.
Because an admission officer, when they're trying to understand what you do outside of the classroom and the impact that you've made, they go to the activity section to find that. So that being in the right space has added visibility and power. The honors section, I think, is very intentionally not in the activity section, but it's in the education section of the Common App.
Okay.
And so the honors and awards there are designed to be a place to report those that are within the academic space, not the extracurricular space. So common things there are National Merit Semi-Finalist, AP Scholar, Scholastic Key Awards. If your school awards a History Student of the Year, something that
would go there. Right. What about, I'll give you an example. Let's say that I played on the baseball team. I played on the baseball team. That's why I'm using this example. Let's say I played on the baseball team and I was a scholar athlete, right? So my school gives these awards to whoever has above a certain GPA and plays varsity sports. Is that something that I could put in my award section? And let's assume that I'm also a really good baseball player. I wasn't, but let's assume that I won all states and I was, you know, had all these awards that filled my activity section. Could I then put that in the award section? What do you think about that flexibility?
Good question. There is definitely some flexibility. I would be inclined to advise to put the Scholar Athlete Award in the academic honors section there, because it has that academic education component to it. One activity that I see often in both places to illustrate the flexibility is the National Honor Society, which is definitely an academic award, but it has this volunteering activity component. And I think this is where students can be a little bit strategic, thinking about how much space they have within their activities list, what they want to prioritize. It sometimes makes sense to have it in the honors section, but if that volunteering with NHS was very meaningful to you, helps fill out your activities list, it might make more sense to put
it there. You led a couple of service projects, if you had a leadership role, maybe you're going to put that in the activity section. But if you were just elected to NHS and you showed up for a couple of meetings and maybe did a couple of things, it might be better to put that in the awards and honors section. You mentioned space, running out of space. And I think just one thing that I want to sort of highlight here is how important it is to take a global view of everything, is to say, okay, I've got all this great stuff. What's the best place to put it in given the limited space that I have? And that way it's a little bit of a puzzle. There is also this additional information section. And I think when you were at Stanford, I would imagine you had a lot of students that filled up their activities list all the way to the gills, and then maybe they had more info that they wanted to put in that additional info section. When is it appropriate for students to add additional content that they couldn't fit into their activities list into that additional info? And is that a good choice for students that might have 11 or 12 activities that they really want to share?
Yeah, great question. There's a little bit of an it depends, I think, around this.
Okay, we got an it depends, the first one for this week's show, but we'll get one, you know, I'm sure there'll be another. Continue.
I do think it is appropriate that if the space for 10 in the activities isn't sufficient, it is okay to roll over into the activity section. However, it is important to be as succinct with the delivery of the activities in the additional info that you would as though it were placed within the activities boxes. I think the quickest way to annoy an admission officer is to paste another essay into the additional information section.
Right.
So you definitely want to be targeted with what you bring. I think that from my experience at Stanford, that space is most utilized to actually go deeper within one activity. So if research is where they're excelling, to maybe provide a little bit more context as to the impact that that research project has made.
And there's something very interesting, actually. I've watched a couple of admission officers sort of speaking to the application in their current role as admission officers. And one of the constant refrains I hear is, tell us whatever you need to know. Like, this is your space. Use the additional info. And I recall doing that as well when I was an admission officer. Now that I'm on this side of the desk, I advise students to use the additional info more sparingly. And I think that's because even as an AO, while I would encourage the use of that, I was only really doing it because I wanted to read some of the good stuff, but when students showed bad judgment in terms of how they use the additional info, or if there was redundancy there, or they uploaded a resume that said all the same stuff that they already said in their activities list, it didn't necessarily reflect well on that student. And so there is a difference, I think, between what admissions offices are saying about what you should share and what is probably the best idea for you in a given circumstance.
Yeah, I think that's a good observation. And the way that I think about it is that you don't want to dilute where you are shining brightest. And I think some students, in trying to get in everything, dampen where the spotlight should be.
I think that's a great point. One other thought, I just want to get this one out about the activities list. Do you have to use full complete sentences? Do you have to, can you abbreviate things? What about punctuation? Any thoughts on that?
Yeah, that's actually a second tip that I like to give to the activities list is a strategy to get in that 150 characters is to write in phrases with strong verbs, typically leading each phrase, led, organized, developed, published, those kinds of things. And then some students like to use semicolons, some like to use commas between those phrases. Pick your favorite punctuation and just be consistent throughout.
Be consistent throughout. And I think one other little tip there is if you're going to use some sort of an abbreviation, make sure that that's an abbreviation that an admission officer is familiar with. You can absolutely write NHS. You can write DECA. But if you have some local abbreviation that you will use within your school that I'm not going to know as an admission officer all the way across the country, make sure that you define that. Maybe in the name of the organization, that 100 character space or wherever else it may be. But you have to make sure that someone who doesn't have your same experiences can understand completely what you're saying with your activities list. Christine, are there any final tips, any like little magic tricks or secrets that you have, or is this just sort of a space where you think students should have a lot of fun and be themselves?
Yeah, I guess my last tip is your personal essay is going to go through lots of revisions. You're going to have someone read it over. You're going to let it rest and revisit and hone it. This activities list is not different from that. Treat it with that same care and thought that you do your personal essay.
And Christine, I think you're one of the very best that we have and that I've seen in terms of understanding and unpacking the activities list. So I think that's a great piece of advice for families to think about. So, hey, you've been on the radio show. Maybe we'll get you back here again sometime soon. Hopefully it was a good experience.
Thank you, Ian.
All right, folks, when we come back, we are going to talk a little bit about that CSS profile, the financial aid form that many schools are asking for. So you won't want to miss it.